Developmental psychology deals with how we mature and grow psychologically from birth all the way through to death. It's a really big subject within the larger field of psychology. In this video, I'm going to talk a little bit about developmental psychology, specifically about some of the general theories and foundational concepts. Because this is a general overview video, I suggest you check out some of the other videos I have on the specific theories and concepts, and the links for those videos can be found below. One of the foundational debates within developmental psychology is whether or not growth happens in a continuous manner or a discontinuous one. Those that believe growth is continuous believe that growth happens slowly but consistently, with no clearly defined stages. People that support the discontinuous pattern of growth believe that there are clearly defined stages that we go through in our development. Most of the theories of psychological development that I'll be discussing in this series and in the video today are discontinuous in nature. However, growth is by its very nature very dynamic, and virtually nothing that happens to us throughout our lifespan happens solely within a continuous pattern or a discontinuous one. Another central debate within developmental psychology is the role between nature versus nurture. This is present in all forms of psychology, but it's especially important when we talk about how we develop. In these videos, I'm going to focus mostly on the psychological aspects of development, but understand that I'm not doing that to say that psychological development is more important than, say, genetic inheritance or sociological influences. In fact, you can't really separate any one component. And that brings us back to a concept I talked about earlier in this series, which is the biopsychosocial model. So remember, we're talking about psychological development, but certainly the biological inheritance that we get and the sociological influences that we experience throughout our life all come together along with our psychological development to shape us into the people that we are today, into the people that we will be in the future. A good example of the biological influence in our psychological development deals with our temperament. The term temperament refers to innate traits that influence how you think, behave, and react with the environment around you. Much of your temperament is influenced by genetic factors, and there are differences in temperament that are noticeable even in newborns. Some babies are fussier than others, some are a little bit more easygoing, and this is a reflection of their temperament. Very early on in life, as babies begin to form relationships with their caregivers and then with the people around them, this temperament helps to influence those interactions. This is where we start to talk about sociological influences on our development. One very important component to our sociological development is the concept of attachment. Attachment is the forming of a long-standing connection or bond with other people. There's an instinct for babies to attach with their birth mothers. It's worth noting at this point that oftentimes when I talk about caregivers, I try to use more inclusive, non-gender specific language. But when it comes to that natural instinct for attachment early on in life, it is specific to the birth mother. This makes sense when you think about it. After all, the babies have just spent 9 months inside of their birth mother. At birth and within the first few days after birth, young babies are able to distinguish the sound of their mother's voice, the smell of their mother, and even recognize the general shape of her face. Now, of course, in many circumstances, the birth mother may not be present, and in this case, the child will attempt to attach to whoever their primary caregiver is. The goal of attachment is for the child to view their caregiver as being a secure base. A secure base means that the parental presence gives the infant or toddler a sense of safety and security as they begin to explore their surroundings. Essentially, attachment gives a young child a sense of safety and security that then allows them to have the confidence to explore their world. Not every child will view their caregiver as being their secure base, and whether they do or don't can lay the foundation for other types of relationships the child will have throughout their life. In many ways, it's important to think of a young child's early sociological development as being reciprocal in nature. As young children are establishing some sort of attachment with their caregiver is establishing their role as parent over the child. Many psychologists have conducted studies over the decades to look into the role of attachment and parenting style in development and have discovered several different types of attachment styles and parenting styles. It's interesting because in psychology, generally speaking, we try not to use very definitive language. Psychologists hate saying you should do this or you shouldn't do that. However, when it comes to attachment and parenting styles, these are some of the exceptions to that rule. Children should view their caregiver as being their secure base in order to have healthy development. Parents need to follow a specific type of parenting style in order to help foster that growth in their children. When this doesn't happen, it can definitely lead to issues later in life. I mentioned at the start of this video that the focus today is going to be on psychological theories. I'm going to give a general overview of four specific psychological theories that you usually need to know in any kind of general psychology course. Please remember that this is going to be a general overview for these four main types of theories. If you'd like to explore them in greater detail or topics dealing with attachment and parenting styles, please check out the links for those videos and you can find it below. The four theories I'm going to talk about are Freud's psychosexual theory, Erikson's psychosocial theory, Piaget's cognitive theory, and Kohlberg's moral theory of development. As is so often the case in psychology, don't think of these theories as being contradictory to one another, but rather complementary to one another. After all, psychology in general, and developmental psychology specifically, are really huge areas of study. It's difficult to come up with just one theory that explains all the different influences a person can experience throughout their life. Each of the theories I just mentioned explains certain components of psychological development. None of them explain all aspects of development, though, and this is why in psychology you must develop many different theories to explain specific components. So let's start with Sigmund Freud's psychosexual theory of development. If you remember when I talked about the psychoanalytical perspective, I mentioned that Sigmund Freud was very focused on the idea that your psychology is split between your conscious and unconscious mind. He believed that there were things that you could remember and recall and are aware of that formed your conscious mind, but then there were a lot of events and influences that you've experienced that you're not really fully aware of, that you may not even know about, and this formed the basis of your unconscious mind. One of the central tenets of Freud's theory is the idea that at birth we have an instinct to fulfill pleasureful needs. He called this instinct your libido. Freud believed that throughout childhood up to about adolescence, the focus of this libido changes. After birth, it's based on feeding and receiving nutrition through being breastfed or bottle fed. As we grow, this focus changes until we get into the beginning of adolescence and go through puberty, at which time the libido takes on more of a sexual component. Freud believed that growth was discontinuous and included five distinct stages from birth to adolescence. It's worth noting that a lot of Freud's beliefs have been criticized today. A lot of his thoughts were influenced by his own biases and the biases of the times in which he lived. This means that some of his beliefs were sexist and not completely based in science. However, his theory is still relevant today because it has shaped subsequent theories. It's also formed as the foundation of the belief in psychology that events that happen to us as children can change the course of our development and lead to problems for us later in life. Freud's theories were hugely influential throughout psychology up to the modern day. One of the people who was especially influenced by Freud was a man named Erikson. Erikson liked much of the ideas that Freud came up with dealing with conscious and unconscious, as well as how events through childhood could influence our psychological development. However, he disagreed that what drove this development was this instinct for pleasureful activity that Freud believed was so instrumental. What Erikson believed propelled us to develop wasn't libido, but rather social interactions and especially social conflicts. He developed a psychosocial theory of development that goes from birth all the way through to old age. This is worth noting because of all the theories I'm talking about today in this video, Erikson's is the only one that includes stages that go past adolescence. He believed that as we age, as we mature, we experience certain conflicts, certain tensions, and how we resolve those conflicts help shape our psychological development and can influence our ability to go through the subsequent stages of development. Erikson believed that growth was discontinuous in nature, and his theory has 8 distinct stages of development. Some criticism of Erikson's theory is that it overly relies on this idea of conflict and tension shaping a person's development. For some people, this may seem like an overly pessimistic or negative view on how development occurs as a result of conflict. However, most people, when they really think back on the events in their life that have been the most influential in their development, would probably point to periods of turmoil and conflict as being critical. Some people, myself included, prefer to view Erikson's theory not as being a series of conflicts and tensions throughout our life, but rather as being periods of change with the opportunity for growth to happen as a result. This way, it reframes his theory in a more positive, optimistic light. The next theory we're going to talk about is Jean Piaget's cognitive theory of development. Jean Piaget is probably one of the psychologists most associated with developmental psychology. He is especially associated with child psychology, and in fact, there's virtually no photo that exists of him that doesn't include the presence of at least one child. Instead of focusing on social influences like Erikson or pleasure-seeking instincts like Freud, Piaget viewed development through cognitive perspectives. His theory is discontinuous in nature and consists of 4 distinct stages of development that starts with birth and ends in adolescence. I'd like to explain Piaget's theory by saying that each of these stages corresponds to a child's way of viewing the world around them. Each stage can largely be related to physical growth that happens within the brain that allows us to mature cognitively. So, for example, early in life, a child isn't capable of higher level thinking. The part of their brain that deals with higher level thinking isn't even really fully developed yet. The part of their brain that is very highly developed is the one that deals with their senses and movements of their body. Because of this, the first stage of Piaget's theory is called the sensory motor stage, and it basically says that young children, babies, toddlers, really see the world through their senses, through what they can see, taste, smell, hear, and touch. As the child's brain develops, their ability to use higher order cognitive functions also increase, and it distinguishes each of Piaget's stages of development until we reach adolescence, where Piaget believed that we were at least somewhat fully capable of all types of cognitive functioning. It should be pointed out, though, that just because you're capable of those higher order cognitive functions, it doesn't necessarily mean that you use them all the time, which can explain why adolescents may engage in activities and behaviors that an adult usually wouldn't. In my opinion, Piaget's theory is, along with Erikson's, the 2 most influential and often used theories to explain psychological development. The last theory I'm going to talk about today deals with a psychologist named Lawrence Kohlberg. Kohlberg was influenced a lot by Jean Piaget's theory, but he wanted to focus more on how our sense of personal morality develops and changes over our lifespan. Issues with morality can be very difficult to study from a scientific point of view because morality can be extremely subjective, and what one person believes to be moral, another may not. Kohlberg decided to look specifically not at moral actions or behaviors, but rather the reasoning that people apply to explain why one action or behavior may be moral and others not. So he looked much more at the underlying influence of morality rather than specific examples of moral behavior. What he developed was a theory that was discontinuous in nature and had 3 main levels. The levels are known as pre-conventional morality, conventional morality, and post-conventional morality. Each of these levels are subdivided into two stages, with six total stages present. Those stages are numbered 1 through 6. Kohlberg believed that most people largely stopped at conventional level of morality at stage 4 by adolescence and continued in that well into adulthood. If you'd like to know more about any of these theories I've mentioned today or about attachment and parenting styles, please make sure to check out the additional videos that I've done, and you can find links for those videos below. If you're enjoying content like this, please be sure to subscribe to my channel and press the thumbs up icon below to like this video. This helps me to continue to expand these videos and provide amazing content to all my viewers. Thanks for watching, everybody.